Thank you so much for coming. I'm not going to translate for Michi, but I do want to take a moment to tell you one little bit about it. Mike Ross, my tutor in Tirio, gave me some guidance, and I approached him and I said, I want to make sure to acknowledge the Pungamate, which is the departed people in my life, and that's particularly my mother and my father. My father was a professor as well. And I said, I'll call Pungamate. He said, no. He said, Feturantia. And Feturantia is about the stars, and I just wanted to say that my father, Samuel Goldstein, was a professor of radio astronomy, and I think he would be very happy to be thought of as a Feturantia. And I'm wearing his gown today. I'm sure he would have liked to have been here. But in any case, I'm happy for you to see so many people today. I'm going to discuss medical diagnosis, as Grant suggested, from a slightly different perspective, from a social perspective. So what I hope to do today, and I also have to make sure I can make this little machine work properly, is to show you how social thinking shapes the diagnoses we come to expect from our clinicians, how medical diagnoses create social consequences for those who receive them, as well as the clinical ones that we expect, and how diagnosis also infuses a myriad of cultural and social locations, which I'll show you a bit later on in the presentation. Ultimately, the reason I do this work, the reason I talk about these things, is because I would like to encourage thinking about how considering the social aspects of diagnosis can benefit its clinical functions and ultimately improve the health and well-being of our communities. So first of all, we need to consider what it means to think sociologically. And here I have a picture of what probably Americans think a diagnostic encounter looks like. It's a doctor and a patient, two people in a room, indeed different clothing, different postures. Clinicians are likely to have been taught about the psychosocial element in the diagnostic encounter. They would probably be making reference to the proximate social environment of the patient, their family, their religious groups, their communities, their relationship to their partners, whether they're part of a faith community or not. But I'd like to cast this social aspect as being something quite different from that. And I'm going to step outside of the health environment to give you an example that we'll have perhaps illustrated a little bit. Here we have, obviously not a diagnostic encounter, but a different kind of one-on-one, or rather two-on-one encounter. We have bad guy, good guys, different clothing, different trappings. The psychosocial factors could be something like angry young man with difficult upbringing. But if we're thinking about it sociologically, we'll see a lot more than just that. You've got more than just the three people in that scene involved. You have institutions, for example. We have the police, and you can see in the background maybe another face, another couple of faces, and they're not protecting the bad guy from the people who've handcuffed him because they recognize the institution. There are norms and values involved in this arrest. I like to use the example, maybe he's being arrested for urinating in public. And I like this example because if he were urinating in public in Courtney Place, they might do this to him But if you were urinating down Highway 87 in Middlemarch, out in the country, you know, he's relieving himself. So that there are different set of understandings of same actions depending on what setting you're in and depending on the values and norms of that particular context. Here we could also ask a sociological question about where power resides and why does one acquiesce or alternatively challenge these sources of powers, the source of power. There are implicit actors and explicit actors. There might be resources at stake. And all of these are sociological concerns that we can see quite easily, I imagine, in this particular scenario of an arrest, but we might not see quite as clearly in the consulting rooms. And that's what we're going to talk about today. I want to add on, because you'll see I'm going to go down a cultural and creative pathway at the end of this presentation. I'm going to go beyond the sociological to look at the cultural. And those two things are closely linked and not often referred to in a medical encounter. But we might ask how these players, either the ones in the arrest or the ones in the consulting room, are accustomed to seeing their roles represented in popular culture, in the media. And that, too, is very important to the subject that I'm addressing today. The questions I asked about the scene of arrest are questions that we can ask about the diagnostic scene, and I'm going to encourage us to keep these questions in the foreground of our mind, whether we are diagnosticians or people receiving diagnoses. I think it would be unlikely that anyone in this room has lived their life without receiving a diagnosis, and I'm imagining, I know quite a few of you have distributed diagnoses as well. So it's a very important tool in our understanding of health and illness. Now, diagnosis is both a category and a process. It's the label that we get when we find out what's wrong with us, but it's also the process by which the clinician arrives upon that label. Mildred Blackster, who is quite a prominent, now deceased medical sociologist, explained the close connection between the category and the process when she wrote this statement here. I'm not going to read it all, but I will point out where she says the act of describing is affected by the descriptions available. So to be able to diagnose, you have to have a language, a set of categories, a taxonomy which allows you to draw from particular areas. It doesn't allow you to draw from other areas. So it shapes what the diagnostic process looks like. But then by the same token, the categories, or in this case, the diagnoses available, will depend on the purposes they are to serve. And actually, forgive me, I will read it out loud because I'm not sure that everyone can see the slide. What it says here is, diagnosis as process, however conceptualized, must be to some extent dependent upon diagnosis as category. The act of describing, if that is what is being done, is affected by the descriptions acceptable or available in the relevant universe of knowledge. Conversely, the nature of the different sets of categories devised will depend upon the purpose of categorization, and in one sense, the classifications are the result of the process. The reference is Mildred Blackster, 1978. So I will start by talking about diagnosis as classification. Forgive me for turning around, I can't actually see the slides. I like this particular quote by Thomas Arnold, who was the headmaster of Rugby School in the 19th century, 1839. He was the headmaster under which the game of rugby emerged. So, what he writes here is, we are not to suppose that there are only a certain number of divisions in any subject, and that unless we follow these, we shall divide it wrongly and unsuccessfully. On the contrary, every subject is, as it were, all joints. It will divide wherever we choose to strike it, and therefore, according to our particular object, at different times, we shall see fit to divide it very differently. And this is 1839. What he is saying here, and I think it's very important, is that classification is about breaking up continuity in order to have manageable chunks that we can figure out and make sense of. Once we make those chunks, though, once we break them up into what Zerubbabel calls islands of meaning, It is hard to see the particular category in any way other than the way in which we devised. So in a sense, it becomes the way things are, with emphatic quotation marks. It makes a kind of ideological sense which hides all the debates and arguments and potential other ways of seeing a category that might have existed before. And we will give some examples of how this comes out in a future slide. But there are a number of social forces. After all, this is the social life of diagnosis that we're talking about today. There are social forces that determine how we divide things up into these tidy little boxes in diagnosis, in contemporary health and well-being. And thinking about those forces, I think, will help to give us more clarity about the challenges we meet as both diagnosed people and clinicians delivering diagnosis. First, in order to be able to classify, we have to be able to see things. We have to be able to visualize, but I'll tell you more about visualization as we keep moving on. But the example of microscopy is there on purpose, because before the advent of microscopy, we wouldn't have been able, for example, to see something like sickle cell anemia. How would we have known that there were sickle cells causing this systemic discomfort, which resembled a number of other systemic discomforts that people could experience? So it was only when they were able to make a smear and look at the blood cells under a microscope that they were able to say, aha, there's a sickle-shaped cell which may explain this particular disorder. Technology is social, and it is one of the first elements that we will look at as we think about our ability to see particular kinds of disorders. And of course, we have different technologies today that are technologies of choice for explaining the things that we want to understand. However, it does take more than technology to be able to see. And while I'm showing you here a microscopic image of a spiral sheet, and this is a spiral sheet which is responsible for Lyme disease, and there might be some Americans in the room, and I think Canadians as well may know about Lyme disease. We don't have it in New Zealand yet, but it is caused by a real life thing. It's caused by a spiral sheet, a deer tick. Yes, we have some veterinarians in the room at least. And these are physically visible. However, we had to be able to ask a question about whether this was something we should look for. And the fact that this occurred, that there was a disease cluster in a particular place, Lyme, Connecticut, Lyme is the name of the town, was actually pivotal to our ability to see this spiral sheet. If we had not had this rather affluent community with a number of stay-at-home mothers concerned about the health of their children and the similarities between these sort of non-specific rash, joint pain, infectious episodes, we probably wouldn't have seen Lyme disease for a very long time. Maybe not at all, I don't know, it's hard to know, but the fact that these mothers were able to speak with the clinicians on an equal footing or almost equal footing, that they were able to argue about the presence of a disease cluster, that the physicians believed them and took it to CDC and other places in order to, this is how Lyme disease was able to exist. It was able to exist because we were willing to see it. Had Lyme disease started in a, inner city Harlem community, perhaps we would still not be seeing it as distinct from other non-specific infectious ailments. So that's, again, a social way of seeing. We have to direct our gaze to something and ask questions and say, is this something that we should be exploring and understanding as disease? And if we look at this little bubby, we might see him as being normal. And just on a particular physiognomic and developmental continuum of normal babies. But what society considers normal will influence whether we choose to see this child as normal or as someone in need of genetic investigation. And genetic investigation in order to explore causation, treatment, prognosis. So as we look at this little boy, or girl, I don't know, we can and ask ourselves whether he needs a diagnosis. We're making a social decision. This is part of the social content of diagnosis. We first have to decide what we think is normal and what we think needs to be thought of potentially in disease terms. Another example. Do you know who that is? No relation to my transcriber. Well, he spells his name differently, right?
Yes, yes.
Who knows this? Zach Guilford, yeah. So Zach Guilford, and before we talk too much about him, let me just say that diagnosis performs an important social role, which is to guard the boundary between normal and disease, between good and bad. And for those of you who remember the story of Zach Guilford, a very successful young junior All Black, went on to play for the All Blacks, did have a bit of a tragic, his father died in the stadium at the World Under 19 or Under 21, one of them. Local GP from Wellington went to try to resuscitate him and was unsuccessful. But anyway, Zach has a drinking problem. And he was arrested in Rarotonga all naked after doing something terrible and sent back to New Zealand. So is he sick or is he bad? That's an important question. In sociological terms, in any case, he is deviant. And by deviant, we mean acting outside of the normal socially expected norms. So he consumes a lot of alcohol and behaves badly when he does so. Certainly was talked about as having a problem with alcohol, as having a sickness which needed management. But in any case, what this underlines is that there is a very blurry line between good and bad, healthy and sick. And these are places in which many diagnoses are generated. And just to provoke you a little bit, I'll show you a picture of someone who you probably don't know. Does anyone recognize this gentleman? No? His name is Wilfred Fox Napier. He's a South African Cardinal of the Roman Catholic Church and Archbishop of Durban, South Africa. I had to read that, so you're forgiven for not knowing who he is. But he achieved some prominence in the media a few years ago when he argued that pedophilia is a disease. Now that's a position which might shock people, or it's one which might seem perfectly normal. In any case, he created a lot of outrage because it shifted the responsibility for what most people at the time he spoke it believed was criminal behavior from the individual to the disease. So diagnosis performs a really important function there. If it's due to disease, to a diagnosis, your bad behavior is forgiven. It isn't really your fault. And that's one of the very strong social functions that diagnosis serves, and it deculpabilizes. And you will be aware of the insanity defenses. You will be aware of the transformation of homosexuality from diagnosis to non-diagnosis. And you'll probably also be aware of the fact that PTSD emerged in the DSM-3 as a result. This was a lot of post-Vietnam War advocacy. Because for PTSD to be a disease was to make its sufferers be something other than cowards. And that's one of the big problems with people coming back from war sites, terribly traumatized, and then being treated as cowards. It was a bit much. For a little light moment of diversion, this cartoon, which comes from the book French for Cats, and I'll try to describe this to you, is a picture of household sections with straight fences and then curvy lines where the cats identify their boundaries. So the cat definition of territory illustrates that cats and people see boundaries in very different places. But we do have a lot of different ways of drawing boundaries, and they contribute to the social life of diagnosis. I hope this is going to work. Yeah. In fact, if I go back to what I said before, what we have is a continuum of nature that we need to parcel up in ways such that it makes sense to us. But the way we decide to parcel it depends on a lot of things. For example, it might depend on the taxonomy that you're using. And here I have, as an example, the Diagnostic Statistical Manual of the American Psychiatric Association. And they do some very powerful boundary drawing. If you look at that first, the one on the top, is a DSM-1. It's just a little tiny bound document. The DSM-3 was sort of a revolutionary one. And this was 1972, I think. And the reason it became so big and so different from the previous version was because of the politics at the moment. Both the president of the American Psychiatric Association, who was very anxious to leave a mark, and the psychiatrists in general were very concerned about the encroachments upon their profession, about them being seen as a somehow lesser form of medicine or medical practitioner. Clinical psychologists were starting to do cognitive behavioral therapy. Medical doctors saw them as very low down the rung. So making a proper taxonomy with diagnostic criteria was one way of reinforcing the profession. It was also a moment, and around the DSM-3, that was the moment when PTSD was included, where homosexuality was taken away. There was a lot of militant action around its drafting, and it set a trend of boundary making, which continues to this day. And of course, we can look at the DSM-5 today, which came out, I think, was when I was on sabbatical last, so it was 3 years ago. And you can see already that the DSM-5 uses the Arabic numeral as opposed to the Roman one to try to be more in touch with truly. That was so. And as they tried to be more in touch, they did a lot of things. A lot of new boundary drawing, we started talking about spectrums. Enough so that if I were to say, haha, they're on the spectrum, you would recognize what I mean by that, wouldn't you? So already in our daily life, we have a different way of understanding things as a result of the DSM-5 spectrumizing many different psychiatric disorders, most notably the autism spectrum disorder. And of course, what you may not have noted with the autism spectrum disorder is that Asperger's disease doesn't exist anymore. So if you got diagnosed with Asperger's disease 5 years ago, all of a sudden you don't have the label anymore. And there are consequences for not having the label in terms of resources, in terms of, I don't know, special education, in terms of a range of different material goods that come from having a diagnostic label. So, but it's not just psychiatric disorders. Phil Brown, who's a marvelous medical sociologist at Northeastern, said the psychiatric diagnosis is low-hanging fruit for the sociologist of diagnosis. But the thing that's so profoundly obvious to me is that these classificatory debates also take place in physical medicine. In physical medicine, when we come up with a diagnostic label, we do so on the basis of discussion, debate, consensus, influence. All of these things are social factors. They're not the way things are. It is not inherently part of these disorders. They are the way the disorders are assembled, put together, and thought about. And we couldn't think about any disorder in a different way. Gout is one that I like to use because gout, which is a problem of the metabolism of certain proteins that then leave sharp crystals in your joints that hurt, but also in your kidneys, so you have urinary or renal problems. And it could be a disease of metabolism, could be a disease of the joints, could be a disease of the kidneys. It could be three different diseases. But the fact that we choose to see it assembled in that particular way creates a structure against which we then understand gout henceforth. Challenging that structure would be somewhat revolutionary. It's hard to undo a structure once it's cemented in place. There are gazillions of classificatory systems. I think this might be a read code. You'd have to click on the files to see. It looks like a read code to you, does it, Tim? Yeah. And just, read codes. Mountain biking example. One of the things, I had a mountain biking accident in Naseby and I stuck my handlebar through my chest. And then I had to be picked up by the ambulance and taken somewhere to the Ranfurly Hospital. And you have to pick a code to describe what's going on. And so the ambos picked the code, I can't remember the numbers, S21 something dot, which meant injury chest. when they got to the emergency room and ran for Ollie, the doctor drew a line through it and said, no, that's a rib fracture. And they said, you don't have an x-ray. And he said, I can see the bone moving up and down. So he erased that, put in the broken rib. But in fact, that was not to be a problem. It didn't really matter. It was going to heal. The problem was going to be the hematoma in the breast, which could calcify and leave a funny-looking mammogram for future future investigations. And as you New Zealanders know, it's better if accidents are ACC, because then you can get them for free. So I had to go to my GP and make sure to get trauma chest or breast or whatever the other code was. So these taxonomies are actually really important for a lot of things, but I'm getting ahead of myself. This lovely image is of shorthand. And the reason I put it there is because diagnosis is a kind of shorthand for encapsulating as much information as possible into a small word or phrase. To identify a person with, for example, influenza is to say, I'm going to read, that they have a systemic illness probably accompanied by fever and upper respiratory symptoms. Their affliction is contagious and is generally self-limiting, although it presents risks in some cases and in some circumstances. One word, in the case of influenza, captures 32. Okay? But at the same time, it doesn't capture the particular case presentation. It explains, predicts, legitimizes, organizes, prescribes, and allocates. And that's what I'm going to talk about now. So diagnosis, we've talked about classification and a little bit more, because I spilled over, but now we'll look at diagnosis as a process. It's the way by which a diagnostic category gets bestowed upon an individual, and that process is a profoundly social one. This is just because it's pretty, it's a traditional, nostalgic view of the doctor. But at the same time, it's an example of the role of the role of the doctor in popular culture at that time. Just in passing, don't forget we still have such representations in films and novels, on TV, in the public view, and that's important. We'll go to that at the end of this presentation, because we do have a way of representing medicine and its importance. And here, of course, we have a very responsible, father-like doctor. So when we look at the diagnostic process, of course, we look at things like diagnostic technology. We afford to laboratory tests and diagnostic imaging the important role of arbiter, taking a prominent place in the diagnostic process, despite their own fallibilities and limitations. Diagnostic tests always require context and are often meaningless without. For example, the bacteria which causes meningitis, bacterial meningitis, can very happily live in the noses of I'm not sure how many of you in this room, but many of you, without you ever developing disease. However, for others, it can cause rip-roaring, fatal bacterial meningitis and sepsis. So the presence of bacteria alone is not enough to establish the diagnosis. Now, less in New Zealand than in some other places, but in North America, and I don't know if it's the case in Europe, diagnostic technology is often pushed shamelessly by commercial interests as well. And please don't get a full body MRI. It will not be helpful. We talk about the incidental coma as one of the consequences of such diagnostic technology. Here's an example of the challenge of context. And this is a picture of an MRI that I saw in a recent news article about fibromyalgia. Now, fibromyalgia has previously been a symptom-based diagnosis, but now we can see fibromyalgia through this diagnostic technology. We apparently now have a brain signature that identifies fibromyalgia sufferers with 93% accuracy, a potential breakthrough for future clinical diagnosis and treatment of the highly prevalent condition. While on the one hand, this most relieves some fibromyalgia sufferers, because having a tangible, visible diagnostic image as opposed to a symptom-based diagnostic tool makes it somehow more real, it's much more legitimizing, and it's much less ambiguous. And I should say that diseases without their own tests often raise the loudest debates, right? This is because, as one of our master's graduates from sociology, John Gardner, explained, diagnostic tests take a far too prominent place in the diagnostic process, despite the fallibilities and limitations. So looking at these brain scans, will it be enough to diagnose fibromyalgia? Will there be a social consequence to the absence of a positive scan in people who previously could be diagnosed by symptom-based diagnosis? There are all sorts of problems in deciding that a particular tool can diagnose over another tool. Of course, we can see as well that the process of diagnosis can be disrupted by outside forces, and this is Dr. Google. Shapes an understanding of symptoms in relation to diagnosis from sources outside of the profession. And we tend to think of all internet information as unhelpful and unreliable. But I should say, just really a quick aside, it's not in my notes here, but there's been something like Dr. Google since at least 1873, because that's the earliest evidence I've seen of it, where doctors have lamented the fact that simple lay people might be able to have access to information that could shape or could actually step on the feet of the doctors and interfere with their diagnostic processes. On the other hand, there is some good information out there, and there's just an awful lot more of it than there used to be in the 19th century. But patient incursion into the diagnostic processes via more than just the internet. Here we have mobile apps, and you probably will be aware of the fact that most of the mobile health apps are commercially designed, some of them by game designers with no expertise whatsoever. So some recent work I've done with Deborah Lupton has shown that there's almost no peer review of the information, of most of the information. Yet, on the other hand, I would not be without my St. John's app. As soon as I get a call, I'm the 111 person in Middlemarch when I'm on call, and I can look at, I've got checklists, I've got dosages, I've got fabulous things that I must have. So all apps aren't bad, but apps do mess around with the diagnostic process, don't they? And the main reason that they do, of course, is because of the exploitative actions of a range of different industries, big pharma, big data, big food. The promotion of diagnostic awareness is at the heart of the actions of many corporations with goods to peddle. So rather than peddling their drugs, which they can do in New Zealand because we have direct-to-consumer advertisement, they have found it's much more effective to peddle a diagnosis for which the obvious treatment is X. So disease awareness, which is something we would possibly normally think of as a good thing, may be used to ends other than those which would have the best clinical outcomes at heart. So to sum up and return to our image, this is not the image we're returning to, but the idea of the doctor and patient as a dyad in a room, this is a crowded room. This is a room which is populated by values, classification systems, which themselves emerge from political spaces and interests, power, authority, norms, and so on. So it's no longer just a one person with another person sorting through their problems. And of course, all of this makes diagnosis a potential source of tension. Many of the tensions of the diagnostic process can be attributed to the social consequences of diagnosis and its social construction. So we'll look a little bit at social consequences right now, some of which, of course, are profoundly important and valuable. Of course, diagnosis is pivotal to the allocation of resources. And here I have a picture of little prescription bottles. You don't get a treatment without a diagnosis and without a, I'm not sure what those are for, but the diagnosis and the treatment are very often tightly linked. You may also, with a diagnosis, get a prediction or a prognosis. You have a far better idea when you can diagnose something closely of what the outcome is likely to be, and that's a desired, it's a desirable thing. But you can also get a shift in identity and a stigma. Here I have, of course, the stigma of HIV on this slide. I am reminded as well of a recent mishap, we'll call it, in the UK, where a diagnostic company had done something wrong with their syphilis kit. And so there were a huge number of false positive syphilis cases. And the people responsible for this mistake said, it's not really that serious. They will have gotten some penicillin, which they probably didn't need, but it won't hurt them long term. other than if they only lost their partner. So a diagnosis does make a very big difference. And there are a number of diagnoses which brand one with a stigma, but even without the stigma, they can brand you in other kinds of ways. We will be looking at the representation of that transformative moment. If someone says to you, Jennifer, you have X, your life is forever divided into before X and after X, and you did notice that I said X rather than some diagnosis because of the sort of magical thinking, we can't actually point to someone and say, suppose you had, no, can't say that, won't do that. Because the power of the diagnosis is, even in our popular imagination, that great. Here we have another example of being exploitable as a result of a diagnosis. You've got the flu, you shouldn't be asking for Tamiflu. So all of these consequences make diagnosis also an important point of focus for popular culture as well. So I'm going to move to the fun part, I hope that was fun, but this is even more fun. Books and novels and TV shows, which all ride on the coattails of diagnosis. I don't know if you've thought about how prevalent diagnosis is in the things we watch on TV or we see in the cinema, but I'm going to show you some. Ian McEwan, Saturday. Now, the diagnosis is already a kind of narrative. If you think of a narrative as being a series of events that are somehow linked, to come up with a diagnosis is to give a structure to a range of dysfunctions or problems. It links that these symptoms are previously isolated, but the diagnosis gives it a context to tell a story that organizes the disarray of disease and provides a frame for its interpretation. Just as it serves to explain an illness and prescribe a treatment and announce a prognosis, it also slots in as a beautiful explanatory or transformative device in contemporary fiction. So be it a novel, a crime thriller, short story, there are many literary forms which use a diagnostic moment to either set the scene, trigger a story, explain or resolve a problem. This Ian McEwan Saturday is a good one. This is a footpath diagnosis. You've got a neurosurgeon who's out going to market on a busy Saturday, and he has a fender bender with some hoodlums, and they come out of the car ready to smash him. So there are three bad guys in this porter or surgeon who one imagines weedy and not very adept with his fingers, I'm sure. He thinks to himself, I'm quoting here, there remains a portion of his thoughts, a droning pedestrian diagnostician who notes poor self-control, emotional ability, explosive temper, suggestive of reduced levels of GABA among the appropriate binding sites on striatal neurons. In fact, he sees Huntington's disease in his attacker, and he does a sidewalk footpath diagnosis. He completely disarms the attacker, and at least for the moment, he goes free. He says, your father had it, now you've got it too. Have you seen anyone for it? Well, powerful, transformative moment. He says he's like a witch doctor delivering a curse. But that's not all, we've got All That I Am. I love this one. I just got this from my local secondhand bookseller who's Jewish like I am, and this is a Jewish memoir, a fictional memoir. And in this case, it's the diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease on about page 6, which serves as a trigger for the protagonist to tell the story of her cousin who was killed by the SS during the Second World War. The diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease allowed her to remember the past rather than to focus on the present. So it compressed time, collapsed time, I think is the word they used. It was just fabulous. So that was that one. But then, Ian Banks, Complicity, crime thriller. I was just reading it because I didn't want to watch the cricket, and it was there in the crib, and I opened it up, and this was at the end. This was in about 6 pages from the end. They use a diagnosis to punctuate in true noir style the simultaneous role of the protagonist as victim. He gets, he gets cancer, and transgressor, not unlike the murderer. So it was really powerful, and I my husband can attest, I exclaimed out loud as I got to that part. But this is not a shopping list, but I'll just show you The Tiger's Wife. I'm not going to talk about it other than to say, when I first started thinking about the diagnostic moment in fiction. I thought, how do you go finding books that have diagnoses in them? Well, you don't even have to look. They come to me as if I were a magnet. And The Tiger's Wife was just on a huge pile of books at my hostess's home in Exeter, where I spoke a few months ago. And she said, feel free to take any of the books on that dresser. So I picked up this one because it has a prize sticker on it. I thought, I'll see what I think. And the diagnosis, I mean, it was just everywhere. But it's not just there. Every new book I come across uses the diagnosis as a fulcrum for narrative. I know you think I'm exaggerating. Start paying attention. I picked up a giveaway, a book from a giveaway pile in Beverly, Massachusetts. There was just some books on the ground. I picked up one. It was called White Helsinki. It was a crime thriller. I like crime thrillers. How did the good cop turn bad? Oh, yeah, it says brain tumor. And that, too, was about page 8. I picked up two books at the Los Angeles airport on my way home, thinking it was going to be a long haul. Both of them had a diagnosis in them. I was picking up my granddaughter's books. I was in Suva, where she lives, and she had a pack of books, and I thought, well, I'm going to read books with her. And I read all of her books, the ones that she was reading. There were 5 of them. 3 of them had a diagnosis in them, important diagnoses. So it's very prevalent in what we do. It's the subject of TV drama as well. And you, some of you have seen House, I'm sure. We had a hard time watching it. But we did watch it. It seemed important. Film studies professor and a diagnostic professor should watch House. It develops the image of medicine as a game of detective, and it draws parallels between diagnosis and law, as these two following pictures will show. So this is House around the diagnosis board. Probably sarcoidosis, right? But look at this. This is the murder board. See the similarities between forensic and diagnostic reasoning? Both seek the truth of the situation. So diagnosis is kind of verdict. And that might also be one of the reasons we pursue it with such a vengeance. And I'm kind of looking at some of my general practitioner friends, because I imagine they see people who come frequently really wanting a name for something. And I actually also think sometimes you go home, if some of you see osteopaths or I don't know, whatever ails you, they don't necessarily give diagnoses. And you come home and your partner says, well, what's wrong? You don't have a word. And you lose the ability to communicate about it. And it does somehow make it less real, perhaps. But this, again, is what happens with diagnosis. Now, I have to move over to the console to do this. We're going to look at Breaking Bad. Have you seen Breaking Bad? Do you remember the diagnostic scene in Breaking Bad? So in this case, diagnosis is the device for character and plot transformation. Walter White, that's his grumpy face there, is a henpecked, repressed high school science teacher who's going to turn into a murdering drug lord, cooking meth with one of his wayward students in order to deal with and pay for his medical treatment. So let's look at the diagnostic scene. Character. and it provided the premise by which the whole series was run. Now, I will show you another one. This is Wit, which is a television film. Is that the word, television film? It came from a one-woman play that was then put to television with Emma Thompson, who's just amazing. We can see in this particular scene how diagnosis, again, is a life-transforming action or moment or event. But in this case, it's one which is fraught with tension. We'll see how authority is asserted and contested, and we will also see, we'll also receive a frame for exploring the predicament implied in acquiescing to medicine's authority. The Emma Thompson character is going to find out that she has a serious disease which is without hope, and yet there is an experimental treatment which she might try.
You have cancer. Miss Berry, you have advanced metastatic ovarian cancer.
Go on.
You are a professor, Miss Berry.
Like yourself, Dr. Gleekin.
Yes. Now then, you present with a growth that unfortunately went undetected in stages 1, 2, and 3. Now it is an insidious adenocarcinoma.
Insidious?
Insidious means undetectable at an early stage.
Insidious means treacherous.
Shall I continue?
By all means.
Good.
I want to return to the clinical setting to punctuate the importance of the social and cultural life of diagnosis. The experience of diagnosing or being diagnosed is far more than matching up symptoms to a particular taxonomy, to a particular condition. What I hope I've illustrated is that diagnosis is more than just a label. It's a negotiable category which is shaped by our ability and our desire to see problems in particular ways and under particular lights. Medicine, like all human institutions, is subject to its own values and contexts and to the values and contexts in which it's being practiced. Once a condition is cast in a particular way by the professional consensus of the day, it's hard to cast it in any other way. Even though the subject is all joints, as Thomas Arnold said, the mortar put in place to glue particular aspects of it into a particular configuration dries very hard. It's difficult to step back and see diagnoses in any other way than the ways which are allowed by the diagnostic systems and diagnostic classifications which we have in a particular time. Even though I have presented many examples of how boundaries are contested and are contestable. And by the same token, the idea that medicine is about medicine and about nothing else, or that diagnosis is about disease and disease alone, is clearly an inadequate way of considering the impact of the diagnosis for both the patient and the diagnostician. Diagnosis so infuses popular and creative culture that the frameworks available to us for imagining the diagnosis and making sense of it are powerfully social in nature. And since the diagnostic room is a crowded one, filled with the doctor and the patient values and beliefs and conflicts and contexts and contests, it behoves the diagnostician to become just as aware of the social life of diagnosis that she delivers or he delivers as with its clinical nature. So as I said before, most of us have either received a diagnosis or delivered one, and most of us probably have a deep understanding of the role of diagnosis in understanding health, illness, and disease. Even though the World Health Organization defines health as something other than the absence of disease, we are all constantly vigilant. We get checkups, we get screening. We now have a spectrum, so we're all somewhere along the way to wherever it is we're going. We can be pre-vivors or survivors. We're all actually pre-dead. But recognizing the myriad ways in which we understand, represent, and even imagine diagnosis with its fluid boundaries and its symbolic importance should improve the experience and the practices of health, illness, and disease.